Well, today I'm very, very excited for our special guest, Marc Mero. Before I introduce to him, but I'm going to give you a chance to really, really cheer here in a second. But before I introduce to him, I want you to see this video clip. All right. Hey, I want to introduce a football and hockey all-star, a four-time New York State Golden Glove boxing champion, a WCW and WWE wrestling champion, the founder of Champion of Choices. Here is author and inspirational speaker and my brother in Christ. Would you give a warm River Run welcome to Marc Mero?
Now, first of all, this and this and this, that was who I was. Today, it's about whose I am. And I want to share my story with you, story of tragedy and triumph, defeat and victory, and God's mercy and grace. It's a message of salvation, renewal, inspiration, and hope. I mean, hope that's offered to all of us that call upon his name. Now, my life is a miracle. It's a miracle that I'm actually here today. It's a miracle that I'm alive. But miracles don't come without trials, tragedies, and tribulations. And there's many of you that are here today that are going through your own adversity in life. Maybe a pending divorce, a broken heart, the loss of a loved one, an addiction. But I believe you're here for a reason. See, I don't believe in a coincidence, okay? Let me tell you, a coincidence is basically when Jesus shows up and remains anonymous. That's a coincidence. But I believe that today, lives are gonna be changed, hearts are gonna be healed, relationships restored, addictions broken. There's going to be an explosion of God's love right here at River Run. If you believe that, give the Lord a shout. Now, you know, it's such a blessing to be back here. This was a church I actually got baptized in about, I think it was about 7 years ago, and now I'm an ordained minister. God's got a sense of humor, doesn't he? But to share my story, I actually want to start at the beginning, so this is where I got to brag just a little bit, but I was the best-looking baby you guys have ever seen, okay? Oh, you laugh? Show them my baby picture. That's a baby, okay? I was like 16 pounds, 19 ounces, man, giant baby. And I'm so blessed. I got the most amazing parents in the world. This is my mother right here. Now, my mom, she's the mom that all the kids in the neighborhood, they always want to hang out at our house because my mom, she treats all my friends like they're one of our family. And here's my dad. Now, my dad, I got the coolest dad. My dad would take me and my friends to the park, and dad would hit baseballs for us, and he would throw us footballs. And not only do I have the coolest dad, but my father, he's my best friend. Best friend I've ever had has always been my dad. And here's me at 8 years old. Oh, yeah. Easy. Now, this is where my story, it could be your story. I think many people can relate to this part of my life. Unfortunately, it's when I had my first setback. It's my parents got divorced. I grew up in one of the worst drug and gang-infested neighborhoods on the west side of Buffalo, New York. In fact, this is one of the apartments I grew up in right here. But it's also where my life started to change, and this is part of the story I really want you guys to hear. That was my bedroom right there in the middle. And I've always been a dreamer. I mean, I dreamed of a better life for myself and my family. And I started doing something different. At 10 years old, I started writing down my dreams and goals. I had this little broken down desk, you know, the cinder blocks and the piece of wood. In this little book, I'd write my dreams and goals down. But see, my mom never wanted to make us think we were poor. I mean, remember in school, you learned about the different social economic classes. You got the wealthy, the middle class. I'll never forget when I heard those words. I came home from school, I said, "Mom, we're lower class." And she goes, "Marc, we are upper lower class." Okay, that made me feel a lot better. But she would say things like, because she never wanted us to worry. My mom would say things like, "Marc, if the ice cream truck is playing music, it means they're out." What? For Christmas, we would get batteries and say toys not included. No, I'm just kidding. She didn't want us to worry. But I started writing down my dreams and goals in this little book, and most of the things I wrote down when I was a kid, they were materialistic. I mean, we were poor. So I wrote down things like, I want a black Cadillac. I want a speedboat. I love sports on television, so I wrote down, I'm gonna be a professional athlete. Not only did I write down I'm gonna be a professional athlete, I wrote down I'm gonna win Rookie of the Year. Wrote it down. I hated living like this. My mom's room was that room right there on the end. And my parents got divorced. It was so hard on my mother. I mean, it broke her heart. My mom had to work two jobs trying to support us, and she would often come home late from her second job. And my room being next to my mom's, I would hear her cry herself to sleep. It used to break my heart. One night I heard my mother crying. I got out of bed. I walked over to the little broken down desk and I wrote in my book, I want to get my mom a house. I want to be rich. I want to be famous. I want to be a millionaire. See, many times we're young, and unfortunately many adults believe that money and fame is the key to happiness. And it's kind of what the world teaches us. And the media portray to all our kids, all these rich and famous people are so happy. The more money, the happier you are. Success is the key to happiness. But the truth is, and I'm living proof, happiness is the key to success. And true happiness will only be found in a relationship with Jesus Christ. And if you believe that, give the Lord a shout. So I started writing down my dreams and goals, and I became, first of all, one of the goals I had was I always wanted to be an author. I always wanted to write a book. Guys, I'm the most unlikely guy to write a book. I can't even spell. You guys ever work on Microsoft Word? You spell a word wrong, it's like 10 words pop up. Okay, Mr. Microsoft, which one? I don't know. So the year was 2008, and I decided to write a book. Me, here's what I did. I took a post-it note, and all I did was write, book 2010. In other words, I gave myself 2 years to write a book. I took the post-it note, and I stuck it on my computer. Now, every day I get in front of my computer, what do I see? My dream, my goal, a deadline. Now, remember, I gave myself 2 years to write a book. Guys, I travel all over the world now. I meet more adults and say, you know, Marc, I always wished I would have done this or done that. Or my favorite one is, Marc, those were the days. No, these are the days. These are the days that we can learn from past mistakes, grow in wisdom and knowledge of things that we could change, go after dreams and goals. Maybe you want to write a book. Maybe you want to start a business. Don't ever give up on your dreams and goals. Most of the amazing things that happen in my youth, first of all, you're never too late. The Bible says that young men will see visions and old men will dream dreams. Now, first word, the word old means mature, okay? So don't ever give up on your dreams. It doesn't matter how old you are. See, for myself personally, I'm never gonna retire. I will only refire. And that's what you gotta do in life. You gotta go after dreams and goals. Like, for example, most of the amazing things that happened to me happened later on in life. For example, I became a professional athlete at 31. I became an inspirational speaker at 47. I wrote my first book at 50. I became an ordained minister at 52. I ran for a seat in the Senate at 61. Okay, that hasn't happened yet, but see, I want you to dream big, go after dreams and goals and never give up. Now, at the end of the presentation, I'm gonna have a little meet and greet at the end here. And guys, we have my book, the DVDs. We have the DVDs today. One is a school DVD and one is a faith-based DVD. So your kids can take this and show their schools and, you know, show it to the whole school. We really want to spread the message of this anti-bullying, this substance abuse, this the heartbreak that's happening in our schools today. I really want to share that. And all the money we make from these t-shirts and all the things that we have back there, it goes for our school program, every penny. So anything that you buy today will not only be a blessing to you, but it'll be a blessing to us. And everything we have is only 10 bucks. So check it out, okay? So I told you I started writing down my dreams and goals. I became very successful in football and hockey, but I found my true passion in boxing. I became a four-time New York State boxing champion. I won the New York State Golden Gloves, the gold medal in the Empire State Games. So to continue my journey with River Run, let me take you back to when I was a boxer. And I still have my little book. I wrote my dreams and goals. You know, I travel all over the world with this little book to remind me when I was 10 years old of dreaming big and never giving up. So I eventually made my way to the USA boxing team. I moved from New York to Colorado Springs, Colorado, and I trained at the US Olympic Training Center. While I was with the US boxing team, I realized I was one of the best boxers in the whole country. So I decided to turn professional in boxing. All the dreams and goals I wrote down in this little book are about to come true. I'm become very wealthy. I'm gonna get that black Cadillac. I'm gonna get that speedboat. I'm gonna get my mother a house. I'm gonna build myself a big house. All my dreams and goals are about to come true. So I fly home from Colorado back to New York. I turn professional in boxing. I had my first professional boxing match scheduled in my hometown in New York. Guys, I have never trained harder for anything in my entire life. I mean, I ran more miles. I did more wind sprints. I sparred. I hit the heavy bag. I did everything necessary to become champion. 2 weeks before my first professional boxing match, I had my nose shattered in an accident. I needed reconstructive surgery, and the doctor said it would be almost a year before I could come back and start having full contact. Now, my mother was with me. We know about the wheelman for my surgery. My mother, she let me walking by the gurney, and she's like, hold my hand. She's like praying with me. She goes, Marc, honey, don't worry. You're going to come back in 1 year. You're going to be champ of the world. You see, the greatest gift my mother ever gave me, she believed in me. She empowered me to believe in myself. Now, some of you students that are here, you're going to be able to relate to this. And you moms and dads and grandparents that are here, you guys are so guilty, okay? My mother would be at all my sporting events. She never missed one. I remember playing football in high school. My mother would be on the sidelines. And if the play on the field started going one way, my mother would run along with us. Marc, get him, get him! I'd be like, oh my gosh. I'd get in the huddle with the guys. I'd go, hey Marc, is that your mother? No, never saw her before in my life. I'm kidding. I could never imagine not hearing that voice. And you moms and dads and grandparents, don't you ever stop doing that. Anyways, the surgery went fine, but after the surgery was over, it was the first time in my life I could ever remember, like, I had all this free time on my hands. You know, I mean, I couldn't train, so I wasn't getting ready for a hockey game, football game, a boxing match. And sometimes we have a lot of free time. We're presented with a lot of choices. And I started making some really bad ones. I mean, life-changing bad choices. The first thing I did wrong, and please don't miss this, I started hanging out with the wrong kids. And these so-called friends that were going to parties, but at the parties, they're drinking, getting high, doing drugs. And what do I do? Follow right along with them. But don't worry, I'm coming back in 1 year. And it always starts out so innocent. I'd go to the parties with my buddies and they say, "Hey, Marc, what's up, brother? Hey, man, have a beer. Oh, you gotta try some of this, man. Come on, smoke this with us. Come on, you're young. You only live once. Enjoy your life." Next thing you know, I'm drunk and high with my buddies, walking around the parties going, "Hey, guys, I'm coming back in 1 year. I'm gonna be champ of the world." I do this week after week, month after month. But I'm coming back in 1 year. 1 year turned into 2 years. 2 years turned into 4 years. 4 years turned to 10 years of my life of drug and alcohol abuse and addiction. And the only job I could get with my limited high school education was in construction as a laborer. That was one of my jobs, digging swimming pools. I remember being at the bottom of those pools just thinking, how did I get here? How did I throw away 10 years of my life? I wanted a black Cadillac. I wanted a speedboat. I wanted to get my mother a house. I wanted to be rich. I wanted to be famous. I wanted to be somebody. I threw it all away because of who I chose to surround myself with. You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:33, don't be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. You see, what God was saying all the way back then, we become who we surround ourselves with. Your friends, your coworkers, they're like elevators. They're either gonna bring you up or they're gonna take you down. They're gonna bring you up or they're gonna take you down. You show me your friends, I'll show you your future. How do I know this? Simple. I hung out with losers and I became the biggest loser of them all because I gave up everything I dreamt about. You know, the saddest part about my drug and alcohol abuse and my addiction, the people I hurt the most were people that loved me the most. My friends would drive me home at 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning. We'd be drunk and high in the car, laughing. We'd pull up in front of my house in New York, they'd go, "Hey, Marc, Marc, the light's on." Oh man, my mother's up. See, my mother would not go to bed until she knew her son was still alive. My mom would stay up all night and sit in this old chair in the living room, and the reason she sat in that chair is I had to walk by that chair to get to my bedroom. I hated those walks. I'd walk in, she'd say, "Hi, Marc, how was your night?" "It's good, going to bed." She goes, "Marc, can I please talk to you for a minute?" I go, "Mom, I'm tired, I'm going to bed." She goes, "Marc, I haven't seen you all day and all night. Can I please talk to you?" I said, "Man, don't you just leave me alone? You know, you bug me." And I'd slam my bedroom door on the one person that actually believed in me. I have a little brother. My little brother's name is Guy Christopher. Now, Guy Christopher, he's 13 years younger than me, but he tells anybody who listens, "When I grow up, I want to be like my big brother, Marc." See, my brother also wants to be a professional athlete. Mike, this kid, all-star baseball player. I mean, his dream is to make it to the major leagues. When he was younger, he'd wear his little baseball suit everywhere. I don't know if he thought the pro scouts were at the Burger King, but he wore it everywhere. And he'd come up and say, "Hey, Marc, can you pitch me some?" I go, "Man, I don't got time for that." And he'd take the ball and he'd like just toss it at me and catch. I said, "What?" He said, you want to play catch?" I said, "No, what's wrong with you? Can't you hear?" And he'd look at me and say, "Can I hang out with you?" "Get out of here, you little punk." I'd take his ball and throw it as far as I could. Now my brother, he would never talk back, but he'd run away after that ball. And when he got far enough away, he'd always stop. And he would just look back. And it was a look as if to say, "I just want to hang out with my brother. Get out of here." I have a little sister. My little sister, her name is Andrea. Now, Andrea was also much younger than me, but Andrea, she used to do something I could not stand. Some of you parents are going to remember this. She'd go, "I'm sitting next to Marc. I call it." Remember the old "I call it" days? So whenever we got in the car, we went to dinner or a movie, she's like, "I'm sitting next to my brother. I called it." And she'd run like crazy to get the chair. I mean, she drove me nuts with this stuff. She's like, "Are you kidding me? Andrea, look at me. Get out of here right now." Guys, I cannot tell you how many times I watched my little sister, Andrea. Her eyes would well up in tears and she didn't want to blink because She didn't want me to see her cry. But that's how I treated my family. You know what's so ironic about sharing that with you guys today? Now that I travel all over the world, I've been a youth advocate for 11 years now. I meet with students and families almost every day, whether it's in person at presentations or through social media. And I realize something so important. We all have an impact on each other's life. Whether it's positive or negative, we have an impact on each other. So my question to you, how are you being treated? Better yet, how do you treat other people? Do people see the love of Christ shine through you? Do they see the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. What do people see in you? You know, every day I receive hundreds of letters from students and families. And most of the letters I get are absolutely beautiful. The common theme is, Marc, this changed my life. But I also get letters from students that are going through isolation, loneliness, depression, anxiety, self-harming, being bullied, burning themselves, cutting themselves. And worst case, students that feel like they don't even want to be here anymore. And it actually breaks my heart. But I spend night after night while I'm on my road in hotel rooms writing back to students that are going through adversity because I want them to know that there is hope. There is people that care about them. They're not alone. Any student, hears my voice, you are not alone and you matter so much. Parents, it's a different world today. I have my finger on the pulse of what's happening at our schools. I did 293 events last year, 35 states. And every state is exactly the same. Students that feel hopeless. They've taken God out of our workplace. They take him out of our schools. But they can't take him out of your heart. They can't take him out of your life. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. Guys, the reason I'm so passionate about this, I was one of those kids. I was bullied so badly as a kid. My mother couldn't afford clothes for us to go to school, so she bought all our clothes at garage sales and yard sales. I mean, we had no money. It was so embarrassing to go to school. I'd often go to school, my pants were too short. The old shoes she bought me, like the heel would come undone, I'd try to tape it before school. I was sitting in class, and this student stood up in front of everybody. He was, "Hey, Mero, I got a shirt just like yours, man. And I got the exact same shirt. That is my shirt. Man, you got that at our garage sale. Man, you're a bum." Everybody caught on to that word, bum. That became my name everywhere I went. "Hey, bum, where are you going, garage sale? Nice shoes, bum. Hey, bum, I think that's my shirt." I would act like it didn't even bother me, or most times I act like I didn't hear them, but I actually heard every word. I was dying inside. When the bell rang at the end of the day for school, I was always the first one out the school doors. I'd be running home. I didn't want no one to see me cry. I'd go home and I just think, why are kids so mean? I'd look in the mirror and I'd start finding other things wrong with me because, you see, when you hear something enough times, you're ugly, you're stupid, you're worthless, your perception becomes your reality. And that became my reality. I hated who I was. I didn't want to live like that. I hated being poor. But I remember my mom said, "You are not defined by their opinion. You are not going to base your life's limitations on what other people think and do." And that's what we have to do. See, we have to be the spark that ignites a fire of change and tolerance in our schools and our workplace. And when I say workplace, there is bullying in our workplace. We have got to burn down the walls of injustice. We have to build bridges of empathy and compassion with each other. Let the love of Christ shine through us. And let me tell you how we're going to do it. We're going to do it by coming together as a school. We're coming as a church, as a community, as a family. The stronger the church, the stronger the family. And we can do this by no longer backing down. We are no longer going to sit down. We are going to stand up, step up, and speak up against bullying and abuse in our schools and our workplace. If you're with me on that, I would love to hear it right now. You are beautiful. You are talented. We have got to bring hope to students who are hopeless. We have got to be the voice of the voiceless. Come on, River Run. Let me hear you. this church. This is where presentation gets a little tough. See, I was also the bully. That's right, I told you guys how I treated my family. It's a huge form of bullying we often don't talk about because it's our family. Oh my gosh, what I put my little brother and sister through month after month, year after year. My gosh, the scars I laid on their life. All they ever wanted was a big brother. Man, did I fall short. I moved out when I was 18. I don't need those people. I'm going out and being rich and famous. Next thing you know, I start getting these phone calls from my little sister, Andrea. Now you guys remember her, of course. I'm sitting next to Marc, I call it. I mean, as soon as she called my phone, I'd let it go to voicemail. And she'd leave me the longest messages. Marc, I miss you so much. I wish you'd come by and see everybody. Dad says he misses you too. Be great to see you. Oh, I'm getting ready to graduate from high school. I can't wait to see you at the graduation. Marc, it's gonna be so good. Everybody's gonna be there. I love you, I miss you. Blah, blah, blah. I never even went to my little sister's high school graduation. I was told she was looking all over for me, and when she realized I wasn't gonna be there, it broke her heart. Then I got a letter through the mail. Remember the old way, the post office? It said, Marc, I miss you so much. I wish you'd come by and see everybody. I'm getting ready to leave for college. I really wanted to see you before I left. I love you, I miss you. Blah, blah, blah. Never had time. My sister, Andrea, she went on to graduate from Syracuse University. She got her degree in electrical engineering. I mean, she has always been so smart. She had a scholarship for school and everything. And she applied for her first job. It was a company called General Electric. It was in Rochester, New York. She wanted this job so badly. Like, she would just sit by the phone hoping they would call. And I remember I had to swing by the house to get something. So she heard the door open, and when she saw it was me, she was like, Marc. She started crying. She gives me this big bear hug, and she looks up, and tears are streaming down her cheeks. She goes, I missed you so much. I'll never forget, she does this to me. She goes, guess what? I got the job. She was so excited. I've never seen her so happy. She had to get a routine physical for her new health insurance at General Electric. And it was at that physical they found my sister Andrea. She had cancer. She went through radiation and chemotherapy. I mean, she lost all her hair. She never lost her will to live. She never complained. I'd visit her at the hospital. She's always worried about me. She's like, hey, Marc, are you okay? My sister Andrea fought so bravely for 8 months. I was sitting in her hospital bed that fateful day when she died. What I would do to sit next to my little sister today, my gosh, what I would do. I call it choices. We are defined by our choices. The choices we make today, they can affect us and our families the rest of our lives. You know what I want to do? I want to share a video that I think is going to really touch your heart. It's about a little boy who lost something very dear to him. And at one time or another, we're all going to lose a loved one. But I want you to know that God understands. God also lost something really important to him. Anyways, this is a little boy. His name is Logan, and he called into a radio station. Well, just play it.
Hey, Mike, can I talk to you?
You bet, Logan. What's up?
I want to tell you something that God just told me.
Okay.
Last night, my dad was roping this calf. And this calf had been born from a really old cow. She didn't have really the greatest milk. She didn't have, like, the vitamin C and stuff.
Okay.
Hold on. Mom?
So cute. I guess his mom's talking to him.
I'm talking right now. I'll be up in a second. But sorry about that. But anyway, she broke her back. And this morning I went out and put her down myself. I was talking to God. I was asking God why she was special. And God said, you know, Logan, my son was special, but he died for a purpose. It's kind of the same thing. That calf was close to me, and God's son was close to him.
Logan, you're so right. It's true. Think you're going to be okay?
Yeah, I'll be fine. But I just wanted to tell you guys that that is so important. Just remember, when you lose a loved one or a pet, always remember that God gave his son too, and he understands. He will always understand. He will always just run to him.
Logan, you're wiser than you know, buddy.
Oh, sometimes I don't think I'm wise. Trust me, I've done a lot of stupid stuff, but I've learned from it.
Yeah, but see, buddy, that's what makes you wise, somebody that learns from their mistakes.
Oh, I just figured I'd better call and share with you guys. Love you.
Love you too.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
So no matter what pain or heartbreak you're going through right now, please know God understands. He sees every tear that falls. He knows your heart. He knows you're hurting. But it's important to know, run to him. Run to him. You know, sometimes in life you get another chance. Sometimes. At this point in my life, I was now 30 years old. Years and years of drug and alcohol abuse and addiction. You know, I was working paycheck to paycheck. I was even dealing drugs to support my own habit. And I had a bunch of friends over my apartment. One of my buddies had the remote control for the television, so he starts flipping through the TV channels, and all of a sudden, he lands on professional wrestling. I go, whoa, whoa, stop it there. Let me see this. Now, as I'm looking at that television, I get this overwhelming feeling, you know, the aha moment. I go, guys, man, I can do that. My buddies busted out laughing. They go, Mark, are you crazy? Look at the size of those guys. They will pick you up over their head and throw you right out of that ring. I said, no, man, I'm telling you, I can do that. My other buddy goes, Mark, are you crazy, man? You're 30 years old. What do you do, start a pro career now? I said, yes, I believe. Now, it was the action I took next that changed my destiny, just like it's the action you take when you walk out those doors. What will you do different tomorrow that you didn't do today towards your goals, your dreams, your passion, your relationship with God? Now, the action I had to take, well, back then, I had to find out where there was a wrestling school. I didn't know how to wrestle. I was living in Venice, Florida, and there was a wrestling school in Tampa. It's about 60 miles apart. I started driving there after work and on weekends. 1 year later, at 31 years old, I signed this huge contract in professional wrestling. And not only that, guys, I wrote about it when I was 10 years old. I was voted wrestling's rookie of the year. Dreams come true, you gotta believe, and yours starts by writing it into existence, putting it somewhere where you have to see it, praying over it. God has a plan and a purpose for each of our lives. So now, for the first time in my life, I got all this money. I mean, I never had money before. So when you get lots of money, what do? You start buying stuff. So the first thing I did when I got my signing bonus, I bought my mother a house in Sarasota, Florida, and I paid cash for it. And then I started buying all the other things I wrote down in my little book. I went out and bought one of them speedboats. Now that was back when short shorts were in. Okay, but then I built my first house in Marietta, Georgia. And guys, you see what's parked in the driveway? It's my black Cadillac. So now I'm rich. I'm famous. I'm hanging out with movie stars and celebrities. I'm having dinner with the President of the United States. Muhammad Ali is coming to watch me wrestle. I'm hanging out with Kid Rock. I'm touring with Gene Simmons and Kiss. Shaq's my buddy. I'm wrestling with Hulk Hogan. I got my own action figure. Actually, I got 12 of them. But then I become a millionaire, and I've always wanted to live on the water. So I built another house on Amelia Island. I got everything the world will say, Marc, oh my gosh, you made it. You're rich, you're famous. Man, I saw you on TV, you are so lucky. But then, after I cleaned up my life and made it in professional wrestling, I resort to my old ways. And the first thing I did wrong, again and again, don't miss it, I start hanging out with the wrong people. Next thing I know, alcohol and drugs comes back with a vengeance. Not just that, now prescription medication and pills, the only difference in my life, I have all the money to buy anything I want. And my world starts spinning out of control. Alcohol, drugs, pills, addiction, bad choices, hanging out with the wrong people. But I always thought when I was a little boy, if I was only rich and famous, I'd be happy. I've never been so empty in my entire life. I thought, wait a minute, maybe if I got a bigger home, you know, with a fountain and tennis court and basketball court and lots of land, because now I'm a multi-millionaire celebrity. So I went out and got myself a bigger house. I got everything the world will say, Marc, you made it, you're rich, you're famous. I saw you on TV, but my world's spinning out of control faster and faster. Alcohol, drugs, pills, addiction, bad choices, hanging out with the wrong people. I got this beautiful home. I got everything the world will say, Marc, you made it. But because of my bad choices, I lost it all. That's right, I lost everything. My ex-wife of 10 years, she walked out the door and divorced me, and I don't blame her. But then I lost over 30 friends. Most of my friends died from their bad choices, suicide, murder, but most died from drug overdose. My friends, they were all rich and famous. In fact, I wrestled every guy that's on that list. Many of us toured for 14 years. The reason why I call it a death list, it's a reminder every day I'm alive of a list I should have been on. My name, Marc Mero, should have been on that list. But I believe I was kept here for a reason. I believe there are people in this church today whose lives are going to be forever changed as you hear the conclusion of my story. Sometimes in life you think, man, it can't get any worse. Mine did. I was on a worldwide tour. We were wrestling overseas in Japan. After my wrestling match, I went upstairs to my hotel room and I fell asleep. There was a knock at my door at 3:00 in the morning. And it kept getting louder and louder, and there was like a banging. So I got out of my bed, I go up to the door, and I look through that little safety window, and I could see it was a Japanese promoter. So I opened the door and said, Marc, you need to call home, there's an emergency. I ran back in my room, I got on the hotel room phone, I called back to the United States, I said, hey, what's going on? I said, Marc, I don't know how to tell you this. I said, just tell me what happened. All of a sudden, she started crying. I mean, she was inconsolable. Couldn't understand what she was saying. I said, just tell me. She said, I don't know how to. I said, just say it. She said, Marc, your mother died. I just dropped the phone. I was so numb. I ran out of my hotel room. I took the elevator to the lobby. When the doors opened up, I remember just running through the lobby, out the doors, into the street. I mean, there was no cars, there was no people. It was 3:00 in the morning. I walked down the middle of a street in Hiroshima, Japan. I remember just looking up and saying, Mom, I am so sorry. I flew home for her funeral, and oh my gosh, I could not walk up to her casket. I just couldn't do it. I watched the long line of people that were waiting to give my mom love and respect, say goodbye. And all I could do was look from a distance, and I kept thinking to myself, Mom, please wake up. Please get up. And I just stood there. And after the line was finally finished, I remember I just got the nerve, and I walked up to her. And as I got closer, I could see my mom for the first time. I mean, she looked so beautiful. She was dressed in white. And I just stood over and I said, Mom, you are my hero. Everything I am, everything I hope to be was because of you. You love me so much. You gave me a life. You worked two jobs. You're the only one that ever believed in me. How'd I repay her? By getting drunk? By getting high? By getting stupid? By hanging out with losers? For what? All she ever wanted to do was talk to me. I wish I could talk to you now, Mom. I wish you could see what I'm doing. Why couldn't I have been a better son? Choices. We are defined by our choices. You guys remember my little brother, Guy Christopher? When I grew up, I'm gonna be like my big brother, Marc. Hey, Marc, can you pitch me something? Not today, man, I don't got time for that. You wanna play catch? I said no. Can I hang out with you? Get out of here. My brother grew up okay. He grew up so much better than me. He played guitar in his church band and he loved the Lord. He married his longtime girlfriend, Gina. I'll never forget those two come over my house with these big smiles on their face. My brother goes, hey, Marc, I want you to be one of the first to know. Gina and I, we're gonna have a baby. I said, what? I'll be an uncle? He said, Uncle Marc. We were so excited. My brother got this really good job, and everybody's new employment, they had to be drug screened. You know, they had to get a blood test taken for a drug screening. Now, my brother, Guy Christopher, has always been deathly afraid of blood. You guys might know someone like this, for example. If you ever saw somebody bleeding, you'd go, oh man, I gotta sit down, I'm getting dizzy. Sometimes a kid, he'd just pass right out. But as an adult, he still had this phobia. And he was sitting in the waiting room of the doctor's office, and the nurse came in and called his name. He got out of his chair and he started following the nurse, and he said, nurse, I'm just getting really dizzy. She goes, oh, okay, sit back down. But before she could come back and grab him, my little brother, he just passed out. Fell over backwards. He hit his head on the floor in the doctor's office. I was on the road wrestling on tour, and I remember getting this phone call, and they said, Marc, your brother Guy Christopher had a falling accident at the doctor's office. He's at the Sarasota Hospital. Now, my first reaction, like, I'm like, I'm on tour wrestling. I'm like, okay, how bad can you get hurt at a doctor's office? I said, would he break his arm? And they didn't answer. It was like this long pause, and she just goes, Marc, can you get here as soon as possible? So I knew it was something serious, so I asked for permission to get off the tour. Of course, they allowed me. I traveled to the Sarasota Hospital as fast as I could. I took the elevator up to the ICU, and I remember running down the hall to his room, and when I opened up his door to walk in, I could see these machines keep my brother alive. I said, no. I asked everybody in the room to please leave. It was my older sister, Jody, my other brother, Joel, his wife, Gina, she was pregnant with her baby. Friends and family, they're all around the bed holding hands and praying. And I just wanted to be alone with my little brother. You see, my mother died 2 weeks before this. How much can your heart take? Everybody left the room, so I went over to his bed. And I just put my hands on the rails. I just looked at him. I mean, he looked so handsome. It looked like he was just sleeping. And for the first time in a long time, down on my knees. I grabbed his hand. I said, God, I don't ask you for much. We need a miracle. He's only 21. He's gonna be a daddy. And just then, the door opens. It's the doctor with my family. So I get up and as they're walking in, I can see this look on the doctor's face. It's a look you never forget. He just says, I'm sorry, there's no brain activity. I said, no, there's gonna be a miracle. There's nothing more we can do. We had to make the decision as a family to let my brother go. It was the hardest thing I have ever done or ever will have to do, to sit there and watch my little brother die. But there was a miracle. We donated his heart and all his organs. Doctors told us that it may have saved the lives of 4 or 5 people that are on transplant lists that may not have lived long enough if it wasn't for my brother's gift. It just wasn't our miracle. 1 month after my little brother died, his precious baby, my little niece, Valika, was born. She never got to see her daddy. But that little girl's a life in our family get-together. She's so talented. She plays the piano and sings, and everybody gathers around her. She's like our little superstar. Her daddy would be so proud. Guys, if I could just go back in time, if I could just grab that ball just one more time. Why couldn't I have been a better brother? Choices. We are defined by our choices. I lost my friends. I lost most of my family. But most of them died from bad choices. My friends, over 30 of them, suicide, murder. Most died from drug overdose. For what? You know, I still talk to some of their parents and their wives that say the same thing year after year. If you could only see his son looks just like him. My gosh, you students that are here, you guys are so beautiful. My God, you got your whole lives ahead of you. God has a plan and a purpose for your lives. But if you choose to surround yourself with people involved in alcohol and drugs and pills and meth and heroin, it's a dead end. I'm not here to preach, okay? I live that life. It leads to broken hearts, broken dreams, broken relationships, especially the most important ones, your family and with God. My mother and father died from their bad choices. My mom and dad died from cigarette smoking. My mother died from a massive stroke after years of smoking. She was only 58. And my dad was my best friend. He died while I was holding him in my arms from lung cancer. You should still be here. If you guys have a brother or a sister, just tell them how cool they are. Tell them how beautiful they are. If you have a mother, a father, grandparents, or a guardian, you tell them how much you love them. That was the last picture I ever took of my mom before I left to go to the airport in Japan. As I was leaving, she said, "Hey, Marc, before you go, can I take a picture with the belt?" Sure, Mom. Who'd ever think it'd be our last picture? I guess it just goes to show moms. You're the real champs. And if your parents smoke cigarettes, you tell them how much you need them. I don't have that choice anymore, but maybe you do. Maybe you can bring hope to someone that's been hopeless. Maybe you can be the light in somebody's darkness. Maybe you can make all the difference in somebody's life if you just put forth the effort. It doesn't take a lot. After losing my friends, most of my family, and my ex-wife walking out the door, I remember feeling something I have never felt before. It was a depression that was so dark, I didn't know how to come out of it. Guys, if you know someone that's depressed, please, please don't ever say, "Hey, just get over it." Depression isn't something you just get over. Depression sometimes needs to be worked through, and you could be the person that helps them work through it. It was Christmas Day, and I had no place to go. My other brother, Joel, was incarcerated in prison for making bad choices. My only other sister, Jody, she was overdosed on pills, wanted to kill herself. It was Christmas Day. I drove to Cocoa Beach, Florida, and I sat under a pier on Christmas Day. The day we celebrate the birth of our Savior. Friends and family come over and there's music and food, and prayer and church and all the beautiful things. I contemplated the end. I just watched the waves roll in and roll out. It wasn't long after that I went home and I retrieved my handgun. I walked into my shower. And what I did was I spread my legs. I put the gun to my temple. I put my back against the wall. And the idea was I would slide down the wall, and when my bottom hit the ground, I would just pull the trigger. And as I sat there, my life flashes before me. My heart was pounding out of my chest. I could see visions of my mother, my father, my brother, my sister. I was so sorry. I lived such a horrible life, and I just wanted to be with them. And all of a sudden, I just started sliding, and this vision comes into my head of hell. It was as clear as I could see everybody in this room, and it was like a sea of people. And what it was is nobody was like talking with each other. They were just in torment, and they were just screaming. I remember thinking, this is not where I want to go. This is not where I want anybody to go. And I fell to my knees. I pointed the gun away, and I just started begging God to forgive me over and over. I just asked him to change my life. See, my life was always about changing everybody else. Don't you know how to cook? Why isn't the house clean the way I want it clean? You should love me more. But when you realize it's you that needs to change, everything around you starts to change. See, I needed a counselor. He's the wonderful counselor. I needed peace in my heart. He's the Prince of Peace. I needed a friend. Man, there's no better friend than Jesus. Guys, he picked me up so I could finish the race. He took me from that death list to the book of life. He is the Son of the living God. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And you can't meet his daddy unless you know him. He is the rock of our salvation. He is the foundation of our faith. He turned water into wine. He gave sight to the blind. Jesus, he committed no crime. He had no sin. Yet they crucified him. It wasn't nails that held Jesus on a cross. No. It was love. His love for you and me. He was pronounced dead. Jesus died. But death couldn't beat him. He rose and conquered the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, hell, where is your victory? He is the undefeated, undisputed champion of the entire universe. River, run, praise him. Praise your protector. Praise your provider. Praise your redeemer. Praise the great I am. Praise the lily of the valley. Praise the rose of Sharon. Praise him, praise him. Guys, the chains are broken. We've been set free. He takes us from the prison to the palace, from the outhouse to the penthouse. Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. The stones will rock. Jesus Christ is Lord. Come on, give him a big shout right now. If I could ask everybody to remain standing, this is a very holy moment that's going to happen right now. My life was forever changed when I finally asked Christ for forgiveness. Guys, this is not how bad you are. It's how good he is. I told you earlier, lives are going to be changed. Hearts are going to be healed. Relationships restored. Addictions broken. I believe that with all my heart. God puts it on my heart, and I believe with everything. See, fear builds mountains. Faith removes them. And I'm going to go around the room. I'm just going to ask you, if you're ready to ask God for forgiveness, I just want you to slip up your hand. That's all. Slip up your hand. Come on. You need forgiveness. You need forgiveness. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. My God, so beautiful. So many of us. Forever changed my life. Let me tell you something about forgiveness, though. So many times we go to God and we say, God, forgive me. But then we can't forgive ourselves. And we keep reliving it over and over and over in our own heads. What if you don't forgive yourself? It means what Christ did, it didn't really work. He did it in vain. He forgave you. But you have to forgive yourselves. So what I want to do, everyone that raised their hand, I want you to come forward. I really believe your life is going to change just like you changed my life forever. I'm going to ask you to come forward. And moms and dads, bring your kids. We got to start training up our kids and know that they can come to Christ. There's no better place than bringing them right here to the altar. So if you raise your hand, you need to come forward right now. Come on, give them a round of applause. They're coming. This is a holy moment. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Prayer partners, can we come up here too? Thank you. Moms and dads, bring your kids. Kids, grab your mom's hand and bring them up forward. This is where lives are changed, right here at the altar. Jesus said, if you confess me in front of men, I will confess you in front of my Father. Come on, there's a bunch more. Come on. No, no, keep it going, guys. It's a very special moment right now. Thank you. We're going to fill this altar right here. Thank you. Thank you, my brother. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, there's some more here. God's just speaking in my heart. There's some more people that really need to ask for forgiveness. Come on. Yes. Come on. No, give it up for guys. Come on. It's a really beautiful moment. I see families coming down. I see my beautiful friends, friends that I've known for so many years. I love so much. And I really believe your life is going to change right now. What I want to do is I want to pray with you. And, you know, a lot of people, pastors, and they bring people up and they pray the sinner's prayer, you know. But let me tell you something about God is asking you to, you need to ask for forgiveness. And it's got to come from your heart. You see, I can get a parrot to repeat this prayer. It don't mean he's going to heaven. It's got to come from your heart. God is going to look at your heart right now. And you made a commitment, a step right now to say, God, I really need forgiveness. So what I want to do is I want to pray with everybody. And I want you to say this prayer back nice and loud, okay? But it's got to come from your heart to God. Come on, there's a couple more. Can we make a little more room here? We got a bunch of more people that want to come forward. Repeat this prayer after me. Heavenly Father, I come before you in prayer, asking for the forgiveness of my sins. I believe Jesus died at the cross of Calvary so I could spend eternity in the kingdom of heaven. And this is the part that's really important. I'm sorry for my sins. I'm ready to turn my life around and live for you. I will worship you the rest of my days because your word is the truth. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, part of the salvation experience, guys, is that the Bible says repent and be baptized. And there's many of you that maybe never were baptized. And people say, well, do you really have to be baptized? Let me just say this, okay? If it was good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for us. And you need, he definitely says, get baptized. Please see Pastor Mitch or one of the elders here at the church later on when the next time they're going to have baptisms. And please get yourself baptized. Do what God's asked you to do. Share your faith with others. Let his light and love shine through you in each thing you do. The way you talk, your temperament, how you, an example to your kids and students, how you can be such an example in this broken world at school. You guys are so beautiful. Look at you guys. Thank you so much. I'm going to go to the back after the presentation is completely over, and Pastor Mitch is going to get up here and say a few words. And I would love to meet some of you guys before you go. I got no place to go, so I'll hang out here for a while. But I'd love to meet some of you before I go. Thank you for having me. God bless you all.